This is CISS 268, and you are in the right room. This is a very small class. So the good thing is that affords us the ability to maybe run this class a little bit differently than I run other classes. This gives us a chance to be a little more creative with how we do things and give you more one-on-one attention and possibly incorporate some more activities in it as opposed to straight lecture. All right. So that's sort of the plan. In the past, when I've had classes like this, that's what I do, and I think it works out so well. I think it works out pretty well. So if we're going to have a smaller class, then we might as well take advantage of the good things about having a small class. All right. There's some good things about having bigger classes too, but there's good things about having a small class. Now, I think most of you have had me before. Is that correct? So you probably have an idea of how I teach classes and so on. So I probably won't give as lengthy of an introduction as I would in my other classes, but I do want to go and hit some of the high points in Angel concerning the class. So let me bring that up. I assume everyone is familiar with Angel and how that works. And just as I walk past there to turn the lights on, if you want the lights off so you can see the screen better, please do so. I'll spend a little bit of time with the basic course introduction bit, and then we will dive right into the course material. Might as well get attendance out of the way. Everyone is here. Most of the action for this class is on the content tab. I do record the lectures, so I will post them when I, you know, afterwards. This isn't one of the nice rooms where the recording is really good, all right, unfortunately. So the recording isn't quite as good as it is in like the IVDL rooms, but at least you have something if you want to go over something again or whatever, or if you miss a class, it's better than completely missing material. At least you can get somewhat of an idea of what was discussed and then ask questions for something that you have issues with. The other thing to keep in mind is I do post, sometimes people complain that it's hard to see the exact code on the screen. I do post the examples as well. So it might be good to like, you know, as you're watching the video, have the example open in Notepad or the editor of your choice. So that you can see it. All right. Syllabus. We'll spend some time talking about that. I'll run through all these very quickly. Then we'll drill down on a couple of them in more detail. Copyright and fair use, I post in all my classes, so you've probably seen this before. This is concerning if you're allowed to use material from other sources. For example, if you were creating a web page, could you use pictures from the Cleveland Browns web page? And the answer is yes, you can, with some limitations. Now, whether you want to or not, that's another question. But the question of can you do it legally, yes. And that's different than the law for, let's say, if you were running a sporting goods store and you wanted to put a picture of a Cleveland Brown there because he was wearing Nikes or whatever, you would not be allowed to do that. Even a personal fan page, strictly speaking, you're not allowed to use copyright material without the permission of the copyright holder. That being said, being that we're in an educational context, we have more freedom. The big thing is like in any class, an English class or a science class or whatever, if you use material from someone else, be sure to put some sort of citation for it. And it doesn't have to be formal. It's not like, you know, ALA or whatever rules. Just put something saying, you know, pictures from clevelandbrowns.com or something like that if you were to do that. Assignments, there will be assignments posted here. We'll probably get to this towards the end of class. Discussion forum is a way to communicate between classes, especially if you think your question would be relevant for more than yourself. Opera Mobile Emulator is a nice piece of software that you should all download, and you can get it for free. All right, it allows you to test pages on a variety of by simulating a variety of different mobile devices. All right, our goal in this class is to develop web pages that look good on a desktop browser, on a laptop, and on a various different mobile devices, various different handheld devices. I do have some actual physical handheld devices that you can use. I have some of the larger tablets, and I have a couple of small phones, too. And we can use them as well. But the emulator gives you a good practice in testing, or gives you the capability of doing some testing without actually having a physical device. And you can emulate a whole bunch of different things. So when we view pages, we'll view them not just in the browser, but we'll also view them for there. Free software, you should download it. Installing a web development environment, we will get to that later on in the semester. Initially, our work is going to be mostly in HTML and JavaScript. Later on, we'll investigate some of the things that you can do regarding mobile devices when you use server-side scripting, such as PHP. So this is some brief instructions about installing PHP. Now, if you've never done PHP before, that's okay. We'll go over that, and we'll talk about that. And so don't be intimidated. But really, how do I want to put this? One of the things of this class, one of the points of this class, is to present sort of the tool set that you have available for solving the problem of how do I make my web page work, whatever that means, both in a desktop environment and on a mobile environment. Now, that can mean a lot of different things, right, depending on that. And there's a lot of different tools that you can use to do that. And some of those tools are client-side stuff. In other words, through your HTML, through your CSS, and maybe even through your JavaScript, you can get it to work a certain way. Some of the tools that you have are server-side. It requires PHP. So we'll learn a bunch of these tools. Ultimately, your job as a web developer is like to piece together the tools that you need for a given situation. It's not like one way is the best way to do it. All right. If it was, we'd talk about that and, go ride our bikes for the rest of the semester. All right. But there isn't. There is a variety of things, and each one of them has their advantages for a particular situation. All right. And it's our job to learn all these techniques and then to sort of develop the wisdom to say, well, okay, in this case, I'm going to take this approach, whereas in this case, this approach is required. At any rate, later on, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. Later on in the semester, we will talk about installing a web development environment to use some PHP. Let's back up and look at the syllabus. Hi. Okay, which class are you looking for?
Accounting for 207.
Yeah, 207. This is 205. 207, I think. Think is on the other side of the building. I'm not 100% sure.
Okay, thank you.
All right, that's okay. I switched fonts on my syllabus from Futura to Garamond just to show you that I've updated them since my other classes. Bunch of different ways to contact me. All right, that's sort of the point of the top part of the syllabus. You can contact me via email. You can contact me via Angel email. You can come and sit in on one of my other classes' labs. All right, and students from those classes can come and sit on this class's lab. All right, sit in on. That way, if you need extra assistance, I have a Monday through Thursday. I have a class in the daytime and a class in the evening. So If you have questions and you can't get your questions addressed during our lab session, you're welcome to come to one of the other classes' lab sessions. All right? It's usually a good idea to let me know just in case there's something special about that day in lab, or like, especially like in a class like this, if no one stays for lab, I typically go home. So like if you were in another class and you want to come into this session, it would benefit you to let me know in advance. But you're welcome to do that. One thing I did, one blessing of my accident last spring, was I discovered that you can use Skype very effectively in an academic situation, or more effectively than you could maybe emails, because I can actually see the code that you're working on. You can share your desktop with me, and I can see what you're working on. So if you can't make it on campus, let's say, for office hours, you know, I haven't defined my office hours yet, but let's say if I define them and you can't make it on class for them, and yet you have a problem, just contact me and we can set up a Skype session to go in and review any issues that you have. And I think it's an effective way to do that. If you can't make my scheduled office hours, there's the lab times, and you can make an appointment with me. Right? I aim to be very flexible. The whole bottom line of this is I'll do my best to accommodate you whatever it takes, and there's a lot of ways that you can do it, but you have to be proactive and sort of reach out to me to indicate that you're having problems. It's hard for me sometimes to get a sense of, is our students okay with something? Are they not asking questions because they understand it all? Or are they not asking questions because they got totally lost and tuned out 20 minutes ago? All right? So you have to make that effort, and I'll do my best to accommodate you. And we have all these different technologies and other ways that we can solve that. Here is our official course description and outcomes, which you should read on your own time because it gives us a sense of what the goals of this class are. All this stuff is pretty typical from all my previous syllabuses. College policies, late work policy. I'm very flexible as far as late work goes. Most of you know that. Your grade will be 3 quizzes, 14 weekly homework assignments, and then a final exam. And that will be a total of 100 points, and then 90 through 100 is an A, and so on down the line. We have here the homework assignments and when they're due. All right. Generally speaking, I make an assignment 1 week, it's due the following week. So the assignment that you have out there now is due not this coming Wednesday, not 2 days from now, but 9 days from now, the following Wednesday. And do remember that we don't have class next Monday because of Labor Day. I think it is next Monday, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So this tells you where we're at. And again, this is flexible, subject to change, especially, again, given the fact that we're in a small class. We can be very adaptable. Are there any questions over this? Please take the time to read it on your own and bring any questions you have to class. And at this point, what I'd like to do is I'd like to talk about the mobile world. All right. I think it's important to talk about this, to put this sort of in context, so that we understand how mobile websites fit into the mobile world. Let's say that you're an organization and you want to have a presence in the mobile world. All right? In other words, your CEO is watching and always hears about all these apps and smartphones and all kinds of stuff like that, and decides, gee, if everyone else is doing that, we need to do it too. All right? What are your options for an organization as far as making information about your organization available throughout the mobile world? What are your options?
Social media.
Okay, social media is one. All right. You can definitely use social media to get your message across. So that's absolutely one. What about, so you could sort of piggyback on the Facebook or whatever, and that would be a good way to do that. One thing Facebook wouldn't give you, though, is, for example, like, you know, if you think of like an Amazon, you know, social media, you get the word out, but it wouldn't have the functionality of being able to place an order, for example, and all that. What would your options be if you wanted sort of that very high-level functionality? Does anyone have a smartphone? No. Yeah. Okay. What are some of the ways that you could put your company's message, put functionality about your company for mobile users?
Message, maybe like Twitter or something.
Okay. Again, the use of social media. Mm-hmm. All right. But again, that's good for getting the word out, but that doesn't necessarily provide the functionality of being able to place an order and track an order and so on. So that's good for some functionality, but many organizations want to do more. In a nutshell, you have two options, all right? And I'll give a, this is a spoiler here. We'll jump to the end of this and say that most organizations pick all of the above, all right, when doing this. And we'll talk a little bit about why they do that, all right? Your options are to make an app or to make a mobile website. So, in other words, I want to look up, I want to visit CNN, all right? I could have downloaded a CNN app, CNN Headline News, and then I would have it. Or I could open up my web browser and type in www.cnn.com and go to it. Likewise with Amazon, likewise with LC probably, likewise with many, many organizations. What are the different advantages and disadvantages that these two things offer? What are some advantages that an app has over a web page, and what are some advantages that a web page has over an app?
Probably quicker reactions on the application side.
Okay, so probably quicker response, and why is that?
Because the programming is on the client side.
Okay. In other words, you can probably put more code on the client, and you might be able to do it without a connection. Maybe. For example, a lot of the games, you can play them even if you don't have an internet connection. You can't see the high score leaderboard or whatever, but at least you can play the game. Whereas if it was strictly a web application, or I'm sorry, a website, it would be difficult to do that. So possibly less web traffic, we can put it that way. What are some other advantages or disadvantages of one versus the other?
Mobile side, you have more security issues.
which one, the mobile web?
Website.
Mobile website? Possibly security issues? In general, you probably could implement tighter control on this side. Which one of them is easier to update?
The app. You mean from the client side or the, from creator side?
From the creator side.
Might be a website.
It'd be the website is easier to update from the perspective of the creator of the content. Okay, if I have a website and I want to change something, I've changed our logo, I go out and put the new image file out there, when does that take effect for everyone in the world? The second I do that. The next time someone requests that page, they're getting a new logo. Alright? So, we'll call that simpler deployment. And that is a huge, huge win for an organization to be able to, hey, you don't have to go and update the app. Alright? Now, there's ways that you can set up your app so it does automatic update and things like that. But the point is if you fixed a bug, let's say, in a website, that fix is made available to everyone the next time someone accesses that website. If you fix a bug in the app, all right, that bug isn't fixed until the app is updated. All right, and again, there's automatic updates for some apps, but people have to verify that they indeed want to do that, and they have to have a connection and all sorts of things. So it's much simpler to deploy the app. Other considerations.
Wouldn't that be conflicting, though, with the website because of your cache that you have with the website?
On occasion, you can get burned with cache issues. That's true. That's true. On occasion, those kind of issues can burn. Other considerations.
I mean, if you have the website like on your own server, if the power's out, like website's not going to work, right?
Okay, correct. Again, and this this requires server up and an internet connection. This you can get by at least with some functionality within an app without connection. Now, interesting thing is we'll see ways that you can actually cache on the users and a copy of it so that if they're not connected, they get at least an old copy of the website. But that involves quite a bit of, involves at least some extra effort on the part of the developer. Which one of them would you expect to be easier to integrate with the camera, with your contact list, and so on?
Application.
An application, right. So an application, you can integrate with other aspects of device. So, in other words, you can create an application that does a lot more stuff, all right, than a comparable mobile app could do, all right? As with everything, though, that's a double-edged sword, because what's sort of the downside of this as far as creating mobile apps? Can you run the same app on an Android device and an Apple device? No. There have to be two versions of, we'll call that, that's platform specific. So yeah, it's more tightly integrated with the rest of the application and the rest of the environment, but in order to do that, I have to write code specific for an Apple device or specific for an Android device. Now, keep in mind, all right, that, you know, there's a way around everything, all right? There's tricks that you can do and certain things that you can do. So there's sort of different techniques that you can use to sort of soften some of these problems, and we'll look at that throughout the course. But as a general rule, yes, you need two applications. Whereas a mobile website, well, you know, one size fits all. You write mobile code, and it's available to anyone as a web browser. Which would you be probably using if you had a flip phone, an old phone? I actually saw a faculty member on Saturday that had, I mean, it was like a step above those old phones that looked like bricks that came in a case that you carried with you, like that. Which one are you gonna, which one would you probably have a better shot with?
Website.
Right. Because you probably have a web browser. You have a web browser?
No.
Okay. But some of those phones do have web browsers. I mean, I remember some of my earlier flip phones. It had a browser. Couldn't do anything fancy. It might not even have displayed pictures, but I could still view and get information off of it. Whereas no one is writing apps for my old, whatever it was, Qualcomm version 1.0 or whatever. All right, no one's writing apps for that. So if developed correctly, can be sort of a one-size-fits-all. All right? Which one? Now, you know that any organization, in addition to having a mobile presence, is going to have a web presence for desktops and laptops and so on. Which one do you suppose would be easier to keep consistent across the board? A mobile app with the website or a mobile website with the main website?
I would say a website.
It would, yeah. In fact, one of the things that we're going to study, the first thing we're going to study right off, is a way of creating what are called responsive websites. All right? And what responsive websites are sites where the code responds to the environment that it's in. Simply put, it will look one way if displayed in a desktop web browser. It will look a different way if it's displayed in a mobile web browser. And a lot of organizations are doing that, taking that approach. And the advantage is all you're doing is you're changing the appearance of it. You're not changing the content of it. All right? So, these are sort of the advantages and the disadvantages. I think we hit the highlights of this. If we have not hit every advantage and disadvantage, I think we hit the highlights. So, develop an app, you're likely to develop both an iOS and an Android app. Maybe you'll develop a Windows phone app. Maybe not. As far as website goes, your choices for making the website compatible with mobile devices, number one, is to do nothing. So if you go to a mobile website and you'll have to see exactly the same thing that you would see at the desktop site. That is almost never the right answer. But if you had simple enough of a website, that could be the right answer. All right? Could be. Because maybe your website is simple enough where the navigation is straightforward. There's only a handful of pages. You could get by with something like that, but that's probably not going to be very often. You could have one website with different appearances. For different devices. Alright. Now we're starting to get talking, alright, about something that could be good. Way back when we first started talking about web development, if you had the CISS 216 class, one of the things that we talked about is the benefit of separating presentation and content. The benefit of separating HTML from CSS. And the benefit is that you can make a change to the CSS and make the website look radically different and have the identical content. Well, that's sort of what we mean by this. And these sites are typically called responsive sites. And there's a little more to responsive sites than this, but the fundamental starting point of this is to have well-written web pages. What do I mean by well-written? I mean separation of presentation and content. In other words, between the HTML and the CSS. We'll come back to that. That's where we're going to sort of start our journey in this class. There's a little more to it, but that's sort of the basic idea. A third one is to have one site with dynamic content. And, by the way, responsive. Now, one thing to keep in mind is I'm listing these as though they're separate options, but really there's going to be, as I mentioned before, sort of a mix and match. If I had dynamic content, in other words, content that changed if I was on a mobile device versus on a desktop device, I would still code the appearance to be responsive. So I would do this and this. This doesn't replace that. This is sort of added on to that. What do I mean by dynamic content? Dynamic means changes. Why would I want to have different content on a mobile device as compared to the desktop?
Less scrolling.
Less scrolling. All right. Two reasons mainly. Less scrolling is definitely a big reason. One is to take into account the limitations of mobile devices. Mobile devices have smaller screens, all right? And therefore, maybe you get rid of some things that aren't essential on a mobile web page, all right? So mobile connections typically are going to be slower than a desktop connection is, all right? So these are limitations. So maybe you're going to cut down on big images, and maybe you're going to make a simpler page, all right, for that. There's another reason, though, besides the fact that there are some limitations with the mobile device, the screen size, and so on. What's another reason? Let's imagine you're sitting at home and you visit Lorain Community College's website, all right? Now let's imagine that you're in your car and you visit Lorain Community College's website with your mobile phone. All right? Are you likely to be doing the same thing? In other words, what might you be using your mobile device to look up on Lorain Community College's website? How is that different than if you were at home browsing on your desktop machine?
If you're looking when the campus is open or closed?
Yeah. In other words, I wanted the hours of the library, I might be driving, or, you know, I pulled the car off the road to do this first, of course, but I might be looking to see, okay, what time's the library closed tonight? All right, it's a quick question. Gee, I'm going to miss the exam. I'll have to call Professor Huffman. What is his phone number? All right. Gee, it's kind of snowy outside. I wonder if we have a snow day. All right. Those are all the kinds of things that you might want a quick answer for. You're probably not going to, say, research the different degree programs at LC and decide, do you want to be a web development major or a networking major. That's probably something you'd want to sit down and do, you know, in a desktop or a laptop or something along those lines. So, one of the reasons that you, or the main reasons why you have different content is that, number one, the devices are physically a lot different. Phones are a lot smaller than a desktop or laptop, the screens are. You interact with a phone differently than you interact with a desktop. The other reason, though, is people use mobile apps different, or I'm sorry, people use mobile websites differently than they use their desktop counterparts. Typically, you're hitting a mobile website to get a quick answer to a question. All right? You're not really going to spend a lot of time surfing it like you might if you were at home going in looking for an in-depth. Now, here's, again, a case where maybe for some cases, some organizations, there really isn't a difference between the two. I'm thinking like maybe of a restaurant, right? If I'm at home looking up a restaurant, or if I'm on the road looking at a restaurant's website, I probably look at the same thing. You know, maybe like what hours they're open, where is it at, what's the address of it, how late is it open, what is the pricing, what's some of the menu options. I could see myself looking for some of those things either at home or when I'm out talking with someone or trying to figure out where to go get a bite after class, all right? But other cases, again, you're not necessarily going to have that sort of thing. And there will be definitely different goals for the users in a desktop versus mobile environment. Now, the last choice is to have two versions of a site. You do that for a number of reasons. First of all, if the content and layout and everything is wildly different for the mobile site versus the desktop site, rather than making one complicated site, it may be easier to make two simpler sites. Then essentially what you do is you have a little snippet of code that works as a traffic cop that looks at each request that comes in and says, this came from a mobile device, I'm going to send them to the mobile version of the website. This came from a desktop, so I'm going to send them to the full version of the site. All right. Again, you still will probably use responsive techniques in this. All right. You may even have a little bit of dynamic content in it, but essentially, you're going to write it so that there's two websites and a little switcher, a little piece of software that switches between the two and directs each request to the appropriate web page. Now, obviously, anytime you see having two versions of something, that should make you go, ooh, that's not good, that's twice the work. Now, there are things that we can do to sort of make our life easier where you're not doubling the work. And we'll study that. In essence, we're not going to study this stuff other than to acknowledge that apps exist, all right, and to talk about them. Maybe at the very end of class we'll review a tool that allows you to take HTML code and generate an app from it. All right, so we'll look at that maybe at the very end of the semester. We're not going to look at this because do nothing. We already did that, all right? We're going to focus on these three things. And we're going to look at a combination of different server and client-side techniques that will accomplish these things. Now, the basics of responsive sort of go across the board for all of these. So don't think that when we talk about this that you can forget all about the responsive techniques. We're still going to use responsive techniques, and we're going to incorporate dynamic content as well. All right? So, what do I mean about responsive techniques? Again, by responsive techniques, I mean a website that is smart enough to know whether it's a request from a desktop or a request from a mobile device. Let's see if we can find an example. Okay, this is a really good example. This is a great web source called A List Apart. It's a good web resource for people that are developing websites. Let's look at it within the Opera mobile emulator. And I'm emulating an HTC Desire, whatever that is. Doesn't have a very big screen. And I'm also viewing it in Google Chrome. All right. Here's a website in Google Chrome. All right. Navigation along the top. Little lad off to the side. Picture. As we scroll down. Down here, there are some smaller articles that are in three columns. Now, could you imagine if this was done on a mobile device? These would become very small and very difficult to read. So instead, notice that the menu is a drop-down here that you click on, as opposed to being across all the time. And as we scroll down here, sort of the top of the page looks the same, but once we get to that more from a list apart, instead of having three columns, it's kept in a one column format. And then finally, some of these things are on the sidebar. Down here, again, are in a single column layout. In general, layouts for mobile devices are going to be more like one column things. It's a lot easier to read than a multi-column. On a desktop, a multi-column is generally a good approach. That's why I like newspapers are multiple column, right? Because you have a big wide newspaper. If the words went all the way across the newspaper, it would be hard. Your eye would be prone to moving up or down. It's similar to that on a very big monitor as well. If the words for an article, if you had this size font that went all the way across the screen, it would be very difficult to read because your eye, again, would go up and down the line. Because mobile devices are small, You don't run into that if you have text going all the way across. It's already in sort of a nice column format. Now, I know the fact that this is the same web page and that this is a responsive site because if I look at it, it's the same URL. Alistapart.com, alistapart.com. I don't see, for example, like when I go to CNN, here's CNN, here is CNN as viewed from a mobile device. Notice it sent me to m.cnn.com. That's a tip off that they went and they sent me, they had a little traffic cop out there that looked at my request, decided I'm coming from a mobile device, and sent me to the mobile version of the site. Now they still may use responsive techniques, but again, this would be an example of sort of the last item on the list of saying, hey, it's too complicated to try to just style this stuff to look different, so I'm going to create an actual second different site. And I'm going to use techniques to make sure that they're in sync, right? So that the article on the mobile site doesn't say something different than the article on the full version of the site. Okay. So, what are the guidelines for creating responsive pages? And we're going to start again the discussion from looking at it on the client side's perspective. Sort of point zero, the starting point, the assumption, is that you have a good separation of HTML and CSS. All right? If you're using font tags and break tags and putting colors as embedded CSS rules on your tags and stuff like that, you're going to have a really hard time creating responsive pages. If your HTML is strictly semantic, it just deals with the meaning of the content. You don't use an H1 because you want the words to be big. You use H1 because logically that's a top level heading. Alright? You can then use CSS to style it. Now not just any CSS will do, because you can write an unresponsive site using these things, but you have to have this as your starting point to make any progress. Relative sizes for content areas. So in other words, instead of saying that our content area is 800 pixels wide, we're going to say it's 100% wide, or we're going to say it's 80% wide, or 50% wide, or whatever. So we're going to express size in percentages. Right? That's a key point. And along with this, we're going to be doing a lot of floating. Now that's not to say you're not going to put a minimum width on something. Okay? For example, it's okay to say like the minimum width of a content area, you know, do 100%, but the minimum width is 400 pixels or something like that. Second, relative size for images as well. In other words, instead of saying it's an image is going to be, you know, 400 pixels wide, say it takes up 40% of its container. So we're going to use percentages for that. You can almost see where this is going, right? Because if you use absolute pixels, then the layout is fixed and is very rigid, and it's not going to look any different. It can't be responsive. Whereas if you use percentages and flows for all the different things, then you have a more liquid page that's going to sort of conform itself to the size of the container. Now, the last piece of this puzzle is media queries. Does anyone know what a media query is? All right, fair enough. A media query is a way to specify which CSS file should apply. All right. Based on things such as the size of the screen, and so on. All right. Media queries have been around since the beginning of CSS. All right. You can, for example, have a different style sheet that applies when you print out a document than when you view that web page within a browser versus printing the page, which makes sense, right? On a page, you might have a background and all these different things going on, navigation. If you're getting a printout of it, you may not be interested in navigation or the background image. You just want the text. So instead of having colors, you might have it a black text on a white background, for example. So you could use media queries to distinguish between if I am printing a document versus I'm viewing it on the screen. Well, we can take that one step further and create a media query to say, if the screen is this big, use this CSS file, and if the screen is that big, use a different CSS file. So that's what a media query is. Let me pull down an example here that we'll look at for essentially the rest of class. Okay. Do keep in mind that when I create these examples, I create them to illustrate a point. I'm not going after any particular design award with them. So here's a sample page that I made, viewed within a regular web browser on a desktop. So this would be the quote full version of the site. Notice a couple things about it. It has three columns. All right. It has an involved sort of background that on a mobile device might not be very good. Might not be good here either, but it definitely wouldn't be good on a mobile device. Notice that as I move things around, There is some floating involved. These get bigger and smaller. All right. Now let's compare that to the mobile version. And again, nothing up my sleeve, it's the exact same file. But the mobile version looks much, much different. Guess what? There's no picture. All right. There's not three columns, there's only one column. The navigation is not oriented vertically, it's oriented horizontally. There's no background image, and it's all in one column. I think I might have said that twice, but you get the idea. It's important, so I repeated it that for that reason. Let's look at this. I'm going to post this example to Angel, and this example actually does the same thing two different ways. And I don't want to talk about the two different ways today, but if you're looking at the example, we're going to be looking at the progressive enhancement one, because that's sort of the typical, that's sort of the better approach of the two. And we'll talk about the two approaches next time. Web page, I have several style sheets. As far as responsive goes, we can ignore these lines, 13 through 19. 13 through 19 are simply compatibility with HTML5 sort of hack files. All right. The real important ones are these two lines. Notice the first style sheet is called Base. And there's no media query on it. What's a media query? Well, this right here. Media equals blah, 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 blah. And we'll talk about what that means in a second. If there is no media query, all right, then that style sheet applies. Applies to who? Applies to everyone. You know, you can actually have more than one external style sheet for a page. All right, so I could have base and base 2 and base 3 and so on. Without a media query, though, that style sheet will apply to everyone. So this base style sheet applies to everyone. All right. The second style sheet, this one, has a media query. And the media query defines who gets it. Who gets it? Well, if it's a computer screen, as opposed to a mobile device, and the minimum device width, the device width is at least 601 pixels. So when I went and I created in the Opera Mobile, I created this 480 pixel wide phone. It's not at least 601 pixels, so that second style sheet did not apply. So, everyone, both the mobile and desktop version, gets the base style sheet. The desktop site then, viewers of it on a desktop browser, get this second additional style sheet that overrules some of the things in the original style sheet. So that's an important concept. All right. We're going to have multiple style sheets in one web page. And why are we going to have that? Well, we're going to sort of have our minimum functionality for the most basic phones in a base style sheet. We're then going to add additional style rules for smartphones and high-end tablets and, in this particular case, desktop devices. We will review these other style sheets next time. Again, they're more so dealing with compatibility issues than these two are really the key ones as far as responsive goes. So let's look at these two style sheets, the base and the desktop. The base says that the body has font family of Helvetica, Arial, Sans Serif. The header goes 100% across the screen and has a 1 pixel solid black border. The nav goes 100% across the screen and has a red border. The display is inline. What does that mean again? Display of inline? Means that the elements, the elements on the navigation are going to be oriented horizontally and not vertically. There's no bullet points on them, so list style type none. The section is going to be a width of 100% and with a yellow border. And any images within the section are not going to be displayed. All right? So that's why on the mobile device, this is our look. Notice everything goes across the screen 100% because that's what we set the width in the base style sheet. We have our borders as listed here. We have Helvetica. Our navigation is oriented horizontally. And lo and behold, even though there's an image on the page, we don't see any images here because we told it not to display any images that are within our section tag. Now, let's look at the progressive enhancement part of it, and that is the desktop style sheet. Sometimes the question is, like, what style sheet does something get? And it will guess all that applies. So in other words, on a desktop browser, it gets both this style sheet and this style sheet. Here is the cascading part of cascading style sheets again. If there's two roles for a given element, which one does it get? Well, it gets the second one. So it sort of cascades on down. So in this case, the base style sheet says that the body should have Helvetica. But the desktop style sheet says the font family is Garamond and Serif. And what's more, we specified a background image for this. So notice the font is Garamond and there's a background image. So both these style sheets applied when we're viewing it in the desktop. But this one, because it's physically placed after it, overrules. So the stuff in there that overlaps the stuff in the base style sheet, the second one wins. All right? We set the width of the navigation not to be 100%, but we changed it to be 30%. That's why we have essentially three columns instead of one column. We've changed the widths of all those things to be 30%, so they fit side by side by side. Lastly, we made the image within sections, instead of saying display done, we made the display inline and set the width to 100%. That's why if you notice, as our browser window gets bigger or smaller, that image gets bigger or smaller, because we set it as a percentage. It's always going to be 100% of the available space. This is known as progressive enhancement because we start off with the most basic bare bones style for a page, and then we add stuff on top of it. So, hey, if you're viewing on a mobile device, this is the basic page that you see. If you are viewing on a better device, such as a desktop machine, then you get these enhancements. All right? How is that done? That's done through these media queries, where we specify what style sheet applies in what circumstances. Now we're going to look at, in addition to this, we're going to look at another way where you start with the full version of the site and then you whittle away until you get a more basic version that will be in mobile phones. It's like, what is it better to do? Start with something simple and build onto it, or start with something complicated and narrow it down? There's some circumstances where you do one, or some circumstances where you do another, and we'll talk about that next time. Yes?
Can you go over the meta line?
Yes.
It looks a little bit different than what you usually see.
The meta line makes it so that when this appears, the text is of sort of a reasonable, readable sign. We're setting the viewport, all right, attribute of the browser, and we're saying the initial scale is 1.0, so that's 1.0, that's like a normal size for this. So for example, if I were to not, let's take this out and see what happens.
So then if you had somebody with, say, a reading disability where they don't read as well, can you have two meta lines for, or would you just create an actual extra style sheet?
Well, there's...
You
could do a couple things. You could create an extra style sheet, maybe provide a link to it. The nice thing is, and again, I'm not sure how you do it in the emulator, but you can zoom on mobile devices. That's a nice sort of feature of that. So if someone is vision impaired, that they could go and do that. But yeah, there's a few other ways that you could handle that as well. Notice what happens when I take that out, though. All right, when I take that out, it's using the browser default, and that's unreadable. So if we put that meta line back in, then we're back in business where it's a readable size. This is one of those, to be honest, you know, I saw that I read that you need to do that, and I just probably copied and pasted it every single time since then, because that's what guarantees that. You can probably... Yeah, this doesn't allow a user to scale it. You could probably play with these parameters to allow users to scale that. I do have to confess I'm not terribly familiar with those aspects of it. But again, the initial scale, what that does is gets the font to sort of a readable font. Are there any questions? All right, let's, for a brief second, take a look at your assignment. And your assignment is research responsive web design. Create a web page that explains a topic and is itself an example of the principles. And include 3 links and so on. So in other words, you're going to create a responsive page about responsive web design. So a page that your classmates could use, for example. You know, gear the page to people in your situation, people that are learning web development and learning mobile web development. So, and make it responsive, which means that it should look different and it should look good on a desktop as well as on a mobile device. Use the Opera emulator to test that. Questions? All right, that's it.